Chicken. Cobb walked down the street with his black bag. It had been 2 weeks since his first and only encounter with Fatima. He had no phone number, only her address. He didn't have to feel strange about not calling her or not dropping by the day after they met, killed a chicken, and copulated. He was acutely aware of the new territory his sex encompassed, and it frightened him a little bit. The Gladstone Hotel had served him well. New territory meant new risk. Cobb was always aware of his shadow in the world. He had to guard himself. A man like Cobb lived in shadows. He didn't make them. Taking a woman outside of the hotel made a shadow. Many things hunted by shadow alone, Cobb included. It was not good to make a shadow. The Brazilian witch was powerful. He felt a little awkward about the contents of the black bag. She was the first woman he had gone to visit since being released from Warkworth Institution. He was bringing an offering, not a gift. He was obliged to make an offering. She had spilled blood on their first meeting. He walked through the open front door. The same black woman came to the front of the building. When she saw Cobb, she turned right around and went up the stairs. Moments later, Fatima appeared. She looked as good as she had the first time he saw her. She looked wild and crazy, and like she was desperate for some cock. But there was something else, something he couldn't quite define. Some kind of hesitation that had not been present the first time he met her. She pointed to the sofa, and he sat down. She sat down beside him and pointed her knees in his direction. "Your name?" she said. "Cobb." "The chicken?" she asked. "I ate it," he answered. "You are very brave," she said. She smiled and she looked beautiful to Cobb when she was happy. "You cleaned it first?" she asked. "I'm not a savage," he answered. "I plucked the feathers, gutted it, cooked it, and ate it. It was good. Nothing like fresh meat." "Yes," she said. And she reached over and took his hand and walked him upstairs. He didn't have to be told what to do this time. He undressed and got on the bed. She came in a moment later with the tape player, and she put the drum music on. "No chicken?" he asked. "Only the first time," she answered, "to make sure you are clean." Cobb nodded his head. It wasn't complicated. She pulled something out of her skirt and brought it up to her nose. Cobb couldn't see what it was. Her hands were covering it. She inhaled through her nostrils one at a time, then fell back a step, dizzy and disoriented. Then she snapped back into position in front of the bed, her eyes crazy, wild. And she jumped on him again and rode him until she was sated, then fell off, unconscious, the way she had the first time. Cobb did the same thing he had done the last time. He jerked himself off on her breasts, but instead of leaving this time, he waited for her to wake. She slept for about 30 minutes, then roused herself into wakefulness. "Where did you go?" he asked. "This I cannot speak about," she said. "Is it okay that I stayed?" he asked. "Yes," she said, "it's okay." Cobb dressed and she dressed. They went downstairs to the kitchen and she made tea. They didn't speak. The black woman was not to be seen. Cobb unzipped the black bag and pulled his offering out. She looked at the live chicken on her kitchen table. "I wouldn't want you to think I was freeloading," Cobb said. "It's very sweet," she said. Cobb smiled a little smile, then said, "So what's this punishment thing then?" "Oh, it's very good money," she said. "I need a partner for the girl men." "Girl men? The fags. You mind the fags?" "Oh, not at all." "Good," she said. "I teach you. Also, next week I have to go north. You feed my cat. I can give you a key." "What about the other woman who lives here?" "She is my employee. I can't ask her to feed my cat." "Okay, good." Cobb left her house and walked home. He was plagued by the thought, "Do I have a girlfriend now?" End of chapter.